This is Duke University.
Okay, hi, my name is Gena Olan. I'm going to start out on a bit of a happier note than Jillian's, a rescue effort in a genocide, so a bit more optimistic this time around. So as you can see from this picture up here of Franco, which is Spain's fascist leader during World War II, there was Hitler. I'm writing my senior thesis on Spain and the Jewish rescue effort during the Holocaust. So I picked this topic because it intersects with a lot of my interests. I'm a history and ICS double major, as Sherry said earlier, and I'm also a Spanish minor. I'm Jewish, and I also studied abroad in Madrid, so this is kind of like a combination of all of my interests converged into one. I recently returned to Madrid in August and September for about a week to do research in the archives of the Central Administration and the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, so I was very fortunate to get that experience. So today, my story begins with examples of three Spanish diplomats and their efforts to help the Sephardic or Spanish Jews escape Nazi-occupied territories during the Holocaust and to help them travel from their homes through Spain and onto a safe destination. So I'm going to give a brief, summary about the actions of these life-saving diplomats. To start off, Bernardo Roland, who was a Spanish consul general in France, and he used his jurisdiction to help save a lot of Sephardim. Because of the shared border of France and Spain and the Pyrenees mountain range between them, France was located in a geographically very convenient location to help save a lot of these Jews. So to do this, Roland granted a lot of visas and helped these Jews pass between the two countries. A lot of complaints were received by Germany to Spain, and they were deemed diplomatic insubordination. Franco never fully verified or accepted these visas always, but Roland often went against direct orders that he received just to help these Jews. Next is Sebastian Romero Radivales, who was a Spanish consul general in Greece. At a greater geographical distance from Spain, it was easier for Spanish diplomats to push the limits of the Franco regime's authority. So he took his own personal measures to save 500 to 600 Spanish Jews. And he also petitioned the Spanish government on these Jews' behalf and actually was able to get Germany to agree to the repatriation of these Jews to Spain. However, at the final moments, Franco's regime failed to follow through with this endeavor. But it wasn't anything on Radivales' part. The slippage was completely the Franco regime's own problems. But his efforts were very incredible, and he still managed to save many Jews. Here he is on an Israeli postage stamp, honored for his brave efforts during World War II. So finally, Julio Valencia was a Spanish consul in Bulgaria, and this was actually one of the furthest consuls from Spain. And because of this distance, like in Greece, he was able to push the limits of the Franco regime's authority. His strong pro-Jewish sentiments earned him the nickname the well-known friend of the Jews in German correspondence. The Jewish community in Bulgaria, as in all of these places, was very strong. A lot of people ask me, how did you know they were Spanish? I don't understand. They're in Bulgaria. Aren't they Bulgarians? But actually, many of these Jews continued to speak Spanish as their primary language. They wrote in a Hebrew-Spanish form of language called Ladino, which is Spanish but written in Hebrew characters. And they had a beautiful temple decorated in a Spanish style in the center of Bulgaria. So their ties to Spain were still very strong, and they considered it their homeland. Most notably, Palencia surprised even his own diplomatic colleagues when he adopted a Sephardic Jewish family's children who were in peril. For the most part, Franco never stopped many of these actions, but this action was too far, and he was actually removed from his diplomatic post. So in these three cases, Spanish diplomats made repeated and systematic efforts to save Sephardic Jews from the Nazis. These efforts on the part of Spanish diplomats abroad needed a counterpart in Spanish immigration policy in order to be effective. So part of the reason for the success in saving these Jews was the fact that they were allowed to enter Spain with no problem. The reason for this was that they were considered Spanish citizens. They were granted this citizenship in 1924 with the Primo de Rivera decree, which treated them like any other Spanish citizen despite the fact that they were Jewish. Franco's minister of the foreign minister, General Gomez Jordana, described this process up here, going through the country like a light goes through glass without a trace. This light through glass metaphor, which is alluded to in the title of my lecture, indicates that these Jews were allowed in Spain, but only for a limited time basis. So they were allowed to go from their country of origin, stay in Spain for 30 days, and remain in transit, and then had to continue on to a third safe destination. So typically this was either to the United States or countries in South America where they fit in pretty well because they already spoke Spanish. This may have been due to the fact that there was a fear that these Jews would influence Spain in a negative way. So in some ways there was definitely still an element of anti-Semitism there. But regardless, it's still remarkable that the Spanish government, a fascist regime associated with Nazi Germany, was helpful on any level to the Jews during World War II. It's really fascinating to consider how these fascist pariahs of the Western world, Italy as well as Spain, actually made the most concerted efforts to save their own Jews during the Holocaust. So I'd like to explore some reasons for this possible historical conundrum. So in terms of the place of the Sephardim in Spain's collective memory, the year 1492 is a very notorious year in Spanish history. It's the year in which the Catholic kings of Spain, Isabel and Ferdinand, issued the Edict of Expulsion that expelled all of the Jews and Muslims from Spain. The Hebrew word for Spain is Sepharad, thus the Spanish Jews are called Sephardim, and their expulsion and subsequent dispersal throughout the rest of Europe is known as the Spanish diaspora. Here on the map, you can see in red the 1492 expulsion. These Jews went to three principal areas. The first was to Portugal and northern Africa, so largely Morocco. The second area was northern Europe, and the third was Muslim Ottoman Empire, where they lived in harmony and peace for many years. The Inquisition continued in Spain into the 19th century. This was a tribunal body that tried to weed out the influence of any clandestine Jews that remained in the country. However, at the same time as this reactionary action was taking place in Spain, Jewish emancipation, where they gained their rights, took place throughout the rest of Europe. The generalized emancipation of European Jewry and the fact that emancipation was understood as the prime indicator of enlightenment and modernity resulted in Spain's international reputation as backwards. At the same time, the expulsion continued to deeply impact the Spanish collective memory and account in many ways for the context in which Franco and his rogue diplomats acted during World War II. The idea that the expulsion represented a historical blunder was popularized specifically in the year 1898 when Spain lost the remnants of its historical empire. In its following post-imperial identity crisis and economic recession, many Spaniards looked back on their history and tried to identify and reevaluate problems in their past. Many Spaniards came upon the expulsion and started to blame this one event in Spanish history, despite the fact that it took place so many centuries before, as a reason for the series of crises that had been hitting Spain for years. So in the 20th century, Spaniards attempted to undo what they believed to be a great folly, which was expelling the Jews. To do this, they granted them citizenship, as I said, in 1924. That's where that came from. So up here I have the Guernica, which is a very famous painting. It's located in the Reina Sofia in Madrid, and I was fortunate enough to go see it myself. But it has a very important symbolic significance. As the Spanish Civil War was the perfect opportunity for Franco to use the Sephardim for his own self-fashioning purposes. The inhumane actions of Franco's nationalist forces against the Republicans in the Spanish Civil War are symbolized for the world to see here. Franco's government, perhaps in a propagandistic campaign, later claimed an enlightened and liberal treatment of the Sephardim during World War II. Most likely, Franco authorized this action and this propaganda and good treatment of the Jews to downplay his own atrocities and to contrast his own brutal fascist regime with Hitler's and try to kind of seem more liberal and enlightened, I guess, in comparison. In all these instances, we see the ways in which Franco's treatment of these Jews is a tool for him. He construed to the other Spanish or the other European states Spain's enlightenment and national culture in contrast to his own international reputation as backwards and reactionary. So here I have a picture of an archival document I came across while I was doing research in Spain, their correspondence with Germany and how it kind of represents how they were allies during the war. So the role that Franco's government, which claimed to but didn't actually take direct responsibility for helping these foreign Jews, really has to be distinguished from the active diplomatic aid on behalf of his diplomats. Multiple Spanish diplomats all across Europe took matters into their own hands to save a lot of Jews. This wasn't the case of a singular anomalous individual. It was systematic and organized. So this is particularly intriguing because members of an international diplomatic community often try not to take strong actions and upset the fine balance of things in a diplomatic setting. But given the widespread nature of intervention, I have tried in my thesis to suggest reasons for this. In many cases, it's hard to definitively show or prove these explanations, but many of them can be suggested through archival and secondary research. So what is definitely clear from my research is the fact that these Spanish diplomats and their actions during World War II are directly connected to the history of the Spanish diplomatic corps. For one, the majority of diplomats came from the higher echelons of society. They shared class, cultural, and educational connections with the Sephardim, which may have created a sense of empathy and accounted for their life-saving actions. It is also clear that during World War II, a vacuum of centralized leadership and rule existed so that Spanish diplomats were able to take actions without the full consent of Franco, but without fearing any sort of major repercussions. The types of violations committed by these diplomats were often dramatic departures from official state policy, and they demonstrate the bounds of power and power relations in a loose and far-flung bureaucratic system. I could see in my research in the archives writers feigning misunderstanding, skirting issues, and pretending to be compliant with policy while actually acting directly in opposition to these policies that Franco had asked them to fulfill. Part of the reason for this was the fact that Franco did not establish a clear agenda for his diplomats or an institutionalized training system for them until the year 1942. The institutionalization of the diplomatic corps clearly represents Franco's attempt to correct the diplomatic problems that actually occurred during World War II and to create a cohort of diplomats that was an extension of his regime with similar ideological leanings as him. Finally, it is reasonable to surmise that the Spanish Civil War had a profound impact on the Spanish diplomatic corps. The Spanish War on Fascism wielded its own power and had its own ideologies, which were independent of German National Socialism. Often, fascism is grouped together as one huge conglomerate, Italy, Germany, Spain. But in Spain's case, this was definitely not true. In this context, the Sephardim, who were recently offered citizenship, became symbols of Spanish national pride, an enlightened exception consistent with Franco's ideology surrounding the self-fashioning of his own unique regime. So ultimately, these rescuers deserve recognition for their roles and brave actions that they took during World War II. Up here, I have a list by Yad Vashem, which is a Holocaust Remembrance Museum in Jerusalem. These Righteous Among the Nations is an attempt for this museum to recognize individuals who saved Jews during the war. So as you can see, countries such as Poland, the Netherlands, France, have thousands of individuals on this list and who are recognized. However, Spain only has 6 individuals, and none of the 3 that I talked about today are on that list. So to me, this is extremely fascinating. And it's a very hard anomaly to explain or to understand why one country would have such little recognition while others would have so much. So to me, this lack of recognition is probably attributable to diplomatic problems between Madrid and Jerusalem, as well as the charged history of Jews in Spain. It was not until January 17, 1986, that diplomatic ties between Spain and Israel even began, which restored the long historical link between Spain and the Jews. Before this moment, the two countries had a very antagonistic relationship, which was clearly indicated when Israel was established and it failed to send a telegram announcing its establishment only to Germany, all Arab nations, and Spain. So pretty much the only Western European nation besides Germany. So in conclusion, my work attributes to possible answers to the historical puzzle of Spanish help to Jewish refugees during World War II. To me, these answers stem from an understanding of the importance of a Sephardim to Spain's nationalistic self-definition, and from an awareness of the context in which Spanish diplomats operated, both literally and figuratively from the Franco regime. Beyond providing ways to comprehend an important and relatively unacknowledged aspect of Holocaust history, my work calls attention to the importance of contingency and competing interests in historiography. So thank you for your time. And